Hello everyone, I am Surendra Jain, Master Teacher of Mathematics in Vedantu. In my weekly sessions on ISI and CMI preparation, today I will be taking solutioning part of CMI 2022, the latest paper, and that was conducted on 22nd of May. I will be talking about part A first. Seems to be very easy paper, but they have, you know, made part of every question by asking four part of every question. So let us see how these questions were. This is the first question, which says, suppose A0, A1, A2, A3 is an AP with A0 and A1 positive integers and G0, G1, G2 be geometric progression such that G0 is equal to A0 and G1 is equal to A1. Now, first part they are saying A5 square is greater than or equal to A0, A10. So please understand, if A0, A1 and so on, A10, they are in GP, they are in AP, then we have 11 terms of it. 11 terms from A0 till A10. So if I apply AMGM, okay, so A0 plus A10 by 2 should be greater than or equal to under root of A0 A10. And as you know, there is a property of AP that sum of first term and last term, then sum of second term with second last term and so on, they all are equal and they are equal to the middle term. So if A0 to A10 we have 11 terms, so the middle term here would be A5. So this A5 has to be greater than or equal to under root A0 A10. If you do the squaring, you will get that A5 square is greater than or equal to A0 A10. So this statement is definitely true. Now, coming to this, the sum is multiple of integer A5. So dear all, as I said earlier, that this A0 plus A10 is equal to A1 plus A9 and so on. And this will be actually equal to 2 times A5. So this entire sum, A0 plus A1 and so on plus A10, this has to be equal to 11 times A5. You can replace A0 plus A10 by 2 A5 and so on, A5 by A5. So we will be having 11 times A5. So it is integer multiple of integer A5. So this is definitely true. This part is also true. Now coming to third part. Here we are given that summation I equal to 1 to infinity AI is plus infinite. Now please understand, if A0 plus A1 and so on, this summation is going up to is approaching towards plus infinite. That means definitely my D has to be, that is common difference has to be positive. Okay, and A0, A1 are positive integers here. So we can say that A0 will be lesser than A1. I hope this is clear. Let me just repeat it once again, that suppose you take N terms here, the sum of N terms would be N by 2 into 2 A0 plus N minus 1 into D. Okay, so this will be plus infinite only if, this will be plus infinite only if this D is positive, because otherwise the leading term of N square, leading term that is N square, which where N is approaching to infinite, is having coefficient as 1 by 2. So this will be positive infinity only if D is positive. So A0 is greater than A1. Now, because A0 is equal to G0 and A1 is equal to G1. So in the corresponding GP, the common ratio, which is G1 upon G0, has to be greater than 1. Now, if it is greater than 1, then every next term will be bigger than in magnitude than the previous term. So you know the sum of N terms of GP is, first term is G0 here, common ratio R power N minus 1 upon R minus 1. So this will tend towards plus infinity if R is greater than 1. So this statement is also true. Now coming to fourth part. Let me use this space here. So if this is finite, as we know, sum of infinite terms of GP can be finite if this mod R is less than 1. Here A0, A1, they all are positive integers. So R has to be positive only. So in this case, R will be less than 1. So if R is less than 1, okay, if R is less than 1, that means my G1 will be less than G0. But because G1 is equal to A1 and g naught is equal to a naught. So the common difference of AP, that is a1 minus a naught, will be negative. Will be negative. So as I was giving that logic here, let me use this space. Sum of n terms, that is n by 2 into 2a naught plus n minus 1 into d, and because d is negative and coefficient of n square is half, so this will be tending towards minus infinity as n approaches to infinite. In fact, this can be seen directly also. If your d is negative, every term will be reduced by a fixed value. So as you move on till n approaching to infinity, your next term will be becoming negative, negative. In fact, they will be tending towards minus infinity. So sum has to be minus infinity only. So all these statements, I think first two were also true. These two are also true. So this completes this first question. I think all parts were easy. These three, four may be a little bit of confusing, but one, two was definitely easy. Now coming to second question, where we are given that any two events x and y are called mutually exclusive when probability p x and y, that is I think intersection of x and y, is equal to 0, and they are called exclusive when probability of x union y is 1. Suppose a and b are events and the probability of each of these two events is strictly between 0 and 1, that is PA is between 1 to 0 and PB is between 1 to 0. Then statements we have to find whether they are true or false. A and B are mutually exclusive if and only if not A and not B are exhaustive. Please understand, this is actually a direct consequence of, you know, De Morgan's law. De Morgan's law says that probability of A union B, or let me first come in terms of number of terms. So A union B complement is actually equal to number of element in A complement intersection B complement. That is the De Morgan's law. Also, there is another statement. A intersection B complement is equal to N of A complement union B complement. Now, if we are looking for, they are saying A and B are mutually exclusive if and only if. So let us go with this thing first. That A and B are mutually exclusive. So if they are mutually exclusive, that means the probability of their intersection will become 0. That means probability of their complement should become equal to 1. And from this De Morgan's law, A intersection B complement will become actually probability of A complement union B complement is equal to 1. So that means not A, that is A complement, and not B, they are exhaustive, because probability of their union is 1 as given in that original, given in the explanation in the beginning. Now similar to this, if you start with this, then you will reach to this thing. That means we will be writing it like this: probability of A intersection B complement is equal to 1. So probability of A intersection B will be equal to 0. So this statement 5 is also true. Now coming to 6th one. A and B are independent, if and only if not A and not B are independent. First of all, we should understand what is the definition of independent. So for independent, we know that P A intersection B is equal to probability of A into probability of B. Just let me tell you, this independence thing can also be defined as that probability of A and B are independent of, you know, whether they are occurring once A has occurred or B has occurred. In fact, it's a combined statement. If A and B are statement, then not A, not B are independent, not A, B are independent, A and not B are also independent. But I'll prove it here. So we are already given that they are independent. Then let us see what will be the probability of A complement intersection B complement. Not A and not B, that is what we are looking for. Now this can be written using this De Morgan theorem only: A union B complement, and that is actually equal to 1 minus probability of A union B, which becomes 1 minus probability of A minus probability of B minus minus plus probability of A intersection B, which I am writing as probability of A into probability of B, because we are given A and B are independent. So if you do the factorization, you get 1 minus probability of A into 1 minus probability of B, which is actually probability of A complement into probability of B complement. So you can see that if A and B are independent, then A complement and B complement are also independent. In fact, if and only if is directly implied, because you know complement of complement is that event back. So if I start with not A and not B being independent, then obviously their complement, that is complement of not A, that is nothing but A, and then complement of not B, that is B, they has to be independent. So if and only if that is definitely has to be true. If one side it is true, so this statement also seems to be true only. Okay, now coming to the seventh part. A and B cannot be simultaneously independent and exhaustive. Okay, let us see. Suppose we assume that they are independent. So if probability of A intersection B is equal to probability of A into probability of B, with this assumption, and let us assume they are exhaustive also together. So exhaustive means probability of A union B will become equal to 1. Let us see if this is true or not, this is possible or not. First of all, probability of A union B is probability of A plus probability of B minus probability of A intersection B, whom I can write like this, probability of A into probability of B. And if this is equal to 1, this should also be equal to 1. Now we can write this as probability of A, probability of B, I'm taking this on the other side, minus probability of A minus probability of B, and plus 1. And you can see we can factorize it as probability of A minus 1 into probability of B minus 1, and this will become equal to 0, which is a contradiction, because we are given A and B are events, and two events are strictly between 0 and 1. So both of them cannot be 1, 1. So this cannot be 0. So that means together this independence of two events and their exhaustiveness is not possible. So this statement cannot be simultaneously independent and exhaustive is also true. So this probability of A union B cannot be 1. Cannot be 1. Now coming to A, B cannot be simultaneously mutually exclusive and exhaustive. I think that is very much possible. Suppose you have two events, like I'll give you example. Suppose we are throwing a dice in which all the outcomes are given by, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6. Now let me define event A as in which I am keeping only 1 and 2, whereas in B we are keeping 4, 5, 6 and 3 also. So you can see that A and B are mutually exclusive also, and they are exhaustive also. In fact, the famous total probability law and Bayes theorem is based on this kind of events all only, where two or more events are mutually exclusive and exhaustive. So A and B cannot be simultaneously mutually exclusive and exhaustive is false. So in this question, I will say the order was TTTF. Three were true, then it was false. Now coming to third question, but before that, I think this question was average. I will not say very easy, because the language is not that straightforward, and if you're doing for the first time, it may confuse you. So this question was okay type. I will not say very easy or easy even. Now coming to question number 3. We are given A equal to 1, 2, 3, 10, 20, 30, 11, 22, K, and V is equal to X, Y, Z. K is a constant. X, Y, Z are variable. Regardless of value of K, matrix A is not invertible. So I think this is very much clear that determinant value of A, if I take 10 common from the second row, our first two rows becomes identical. So 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So irrespective of what value of K is, this determinant is going to become equal to 0. So that means A cannot be invertible. A can't be invertible. And invertible, as per definition, there cannot be any B for which BA becomes equal to I. 3 into 3 identity matrix. So regardless of value of k, the matrix is non-invertible. So I think this is true. They are saying non-invertible. It is non-invertible, so this is true. Now I think 10th part is also direct. There is a unique value of k such that determinant of a is 0. I think we have just proved that this a becomes equal to 0 for all k belongs to all k belongs to real number. So there is no unique value of k for which it will become 0. It is actually any value of k for which determinant of a is 0. So this seems to be false. So there is a unique k such that determinant of a is 0 is false. So this is 10th part. Now coming to 11th part. It is saying set of solutions x, y, z of the matrix equation A into V is equal to 0, 0, 0 is either a line or a plane containing the origin. So if I multiply these two things, so what we will be getting? We will be getting, if I'm multiplying A with V. So first row, first column, we get x plus y plus z is equal to 0. Second row, second column, also the same thing because 10x plus 20y, I think it should have been, just 1 minute, it should have been x plus 2y plus 3z is equal to 0. And here also 10x plus 20y plus 30z is equal to 0. But these two are same thing. We are just repeating them because we take 10 common, we get same thing. And other one is 11x plus 22y plus kz is equal to 0. Now, please understand. They have not given any value of k in this 11th part. Is either a line or a plane. So I'll take two cases. Suppose k is equal to 11. In that case, you can check this third equation also becomes same. Not 11, 33. Sorry, 33. If I take k equal to 33, then you can check this third equation also becomes same thing. X plus 2y plus 3z is equal to 0. So all the three equations are same, and which is nothing but a plane passing through origin. So it's a plane containing the origin. Now, if k is not equal to 33, in that case, we are having just two planes. One is x plus 2y plus 3z is equal to 0, which is actually from the two equations. Both the equations are same. And other one would be, you can take x plus 2y, you can write like this, plus k upon 11 into z is equal to 0. So if k is not 33, then these two will be non-parallel planes. They will be non-parallel planes. You know that if they are parallel, then all the coefficients x, y, and z should be in same ratio. For that, k has to be 33. So if they are non-parallel planes and they are just two, so two non-parallel planes has to cut each other at some straight line. So that means if k is not 33, then it will be a line. If k is equal to 33, then it will be a plane. In both cases, you can see origin lies either on this plane alone or in both the planes. So if it's a straight line, then also origin will be lying on it. If it's a plane, then also origin will be lying on it. So answer for this will be true. So the set of solutions is either a line or plane. So this is true. Now coming to the second other part, the fourth part, that equation has a solution, then it must be true that Q is equal to 10P. Now, if I write this matrix equation as a linear equation in three variable, then it will be x plus 2y plus 3z is equal to p. Then 10x plus 20y plus 30z is equal to q. And then there will be third equation also, not required to be written, but let me just write it. Plus k times z is equal to r. Now, as you can see, these two represents parallel planes. Coefficients of x, y, z are in same proportion. So if we want a solution, these two planes has to be same. Otherwise, what will happen? We will be having two parallel planes. If these two are parallel planes at a distance, then there will be two parallel planes and they will not have any point in common. So whatever x that is going to satisfy it, it will not satisfy it. So we cannot have any simultaneous solution. Okay, so if we want a simultaneous solution of all these three equations, in that case, these two parallel planes should become identical. And that is only possible. These two become identical only if this q is equal to 10p, because the ratio of corresponding coefficient is 10, so q should also be 10 times p. So what they are writing is absolutely true. So complete thing is that the first three were t, f, t, and now it is t. Okay, so this completes this question. I think first two part was just too easy. This is also easy, I will say. Maybe a little bit of confusing, but not that difficult. And same way, 12. Now coming to question number 4, it says consider the following conditions on a function f whose domain is closed interval 0, 1. For any condition involving a limit, at the endpoints use the relevant one-sided limit. Because the domain is 0 to 1, so we cannot go to left of 1 or right of 1. So if required, we will use one-sided limit. So statement 1 says f is differentiable at each x belongs to 0, 1, both sides closed. 2, f is continuous at each x belongs to closed interval 0, 1. And the set f x such that x belongs to 0, 1 has maximum element and a minimum element. First part is that 1 is true, then 2 is true. So I think if function is differentiable, then it has to be continuous, so it is true. There is no, I think, any other thought about it. Differentiability always implies continuity. That's a famous, you know, property theorem, you can say. 2, if f is continuous, then 3, that means the set has maximum element and minimum element. So please understand, if this function is continuous, that is from 0 to 1, in that case, from 0 to 1, graph should be drawn like this without lifting a pen. So there has to be some maximum value and there has to be some minimum value if it is continuous. Dear all, I would like to say that if somebody says that a function is continuous but it is constant, in that case all the values are same. So will you still say maximum element or minimum element? For that, what I will say here, that what they mean to say here, that in this case, when we are saying a maximum element, this is some value, let us say capital M, greater than which we cannot have in this set. So in that sense, this is a maximum element. Similarly, minimum element, let us say small m, so we will call this as minimum because we cannot have any value that is smaller than this. So in this sense, I will go with that this statement is true. Although some people may say that when we are saying maximum and minimum, then there should be different value. If you go with that, then there can be a scope of, you know, discussion here. But I will still say this to be a true statement. Now coming to 15th. 3 is false. 3 is false means set fx has a maximum element and minimum element. Now please understand, if I go with this thing what I said just now, in that case, maximum or minimum will not happen only if your function goes up to infinity. And infinity happens only if you have asymptote. That means from 0 at some point you go till infinite like this. Then only your range will be truly going towards infinite. If it is continuous, okay, then at whatever higher point you have to come back. This higher point may come at 10,000 or 10 million or 10 million, but that is still a finite point. In order to go to a true infinite point, so that maximum or minimum doesn't happen, I think we need to have asymptote like this. In that case, this function will not be defined at this point, or maybe we can do this thing, like we go like this and we make a point here. Yeah, that's a possibility, that just before that point, let us say A, you are going to infinity. At A point, we are having a finite value, and after A, maybe you are coming from minus infinity or going like this. So in this case, you can say neither minimum exists nor maximum exists. You could have got your graph from, you know, above also, so that only maximum will not happen, minimum will still be happening. But let us read this question. If 3 is false, that means maximum or minimum is not happening. In that case, statement 1 is false because this function has to be discontinuous in this case. So this statement is false, hence this will be true. Okay, so statement 3 false only if you have some kind of asymptote going, okay, and your graph is going to infinity, and at that point where you have asymptote, you are defining your function separately so that domain remains 0, 1 only. We are given the domain is 0, 1. So every point within this interval, your function should be defined. So 3 will be false, then 1 will also be false. Now coming to 16. No two of the three given conditions are equivalent to each other. No two of three conditions are equivalent to each other. Two statements being equivalent means each implies the other. Now please see, does 1 implies 2? That is true. But does 2 implies 1? I think not true. That means statement 1 is not equivalent to statement 2. Okay, because two statements being equivalent means each implies the other. So 1 implies 2, but 2 doesn't implies 1. So 1 and 2 are not equivalent. Now 1, 2, 3. I think 1, 2, 3, I think it is implied, because if it is differentiable, then it will be continuous. And if it is continuous, then maximum, minimum will happen. But will it be other way? I don't think so, because if your maximum, minimum is, you know, is defined. Let me make a diagram. I think I have another slide also for 16, 1, and I am talking about 1 with 3. So 1 implies 3, but suppose this 3 is true, that means we have maximum value this point and we have minimum value, let us say this point. This is 0 here, this is 1 here. But you can see, despite being maximum and minimum defined, my function is not continuous, hence it is not differentiable. So 1 implies 3, but 3 does not imply 1. Similarly, 2 does implies 3, but 3 does not imply 2. 3 does not imply 2. Hence 16, no two of three given conditions are equivalent to each other is also true. So I think here also all are 2, 2, 2. Now coming to question number 5. This question, I will say, first one was direct. This is also more or less direct. 16 was a little bit confusing. 15 is also. So as per exam environment, I will say 2 were easy, 2 were not easy. Now 17th question, I think this seems too easy. Here we are given that A equal to 1 upon ln 3. So using change of base rule, we can write ln 3, 1 upon ln 3 as log of E base 3. And from that, removing log will give us 3 power A, because 3 base E means, base 3 means 3 power A is equal to E. So this is definitely true. Now coming to 18. Here we can write sine of 0.02 as, by using sine 2 theta formula, 2 times sine theta into cos theta. And you know cos theta is always less than or equal to 1. This angle is not 0, although approaching to 0, but it is not equal to 1. This angle is not a multiple of 2 pi also. So definitely we can say this value is going to be lesser than, in fact, strictly lesser than sine of 0.01 into 1. If I replace cos of 0.01 by 1, I think this thing will be lesser than that. So sine of 0.02 is less than 2 times sine 0.01. So this is also true. Okay, now coming to 19th question. It is asking arc 10 means 10 inverse, I think. So dear all, you please understand, tan inverse x minus x, if I take this as a function, okay, you can check f dash x, derivative of this function is 1 upon 1 plus x square minus 1, which will be, you know, less than or equal to 0. Let me do a little bit of calculation also here. If you take LCM, we will be getting minus x square upon 1 plus x square. So this is less than or equal to 0, and equal to 0 only at x is equal to 0, and also this function is 0 at x is equal to 0. That means function at 0.01 has to be less than 0, because at 0 derivative is 0, but as you move forward, derivative is negative, so function is bound to become, you know, bound to decrease. Decrease means value will be now lesser than 0, which means tan inverse of 0.01 will be less than 0.01. So this completes this solution of this 19th part. I think this is false here, because they are saying this tan inverse is greater than 0.01. So this is false here. In fact, you could have done it directly also. There is a one famous result, if you remember, that as theta tends to 0, tan theta upon theta is greater than 1. Theta positive, theta approaching to 0, this limit is greater than 1. And here, tan inverse of something is like an angle. You can use like this also, writing x upon tan inverse here will be greater than 1. So tan inverse x will be lesser than x, where as they are giving this as greater than. So this is false. Now coming to the last part of this question, just simple integration. 4 times 0 to 1 tan inverse x dx. So using integration by part, we can write this as first we'll take 1 as the second function. So x into tan inverse x, whose limit is from 0 to 1, minus integration 0 to 1 x into 1 upon 1 plus x square dx. Putting limit in this first part, we get pi by 4 here, okay, minus 0. So let us not write it. And integration of it would be 1 upon 2 ln 1 plus x square. Just put 1 plus x square as t, and this integration is direct 0 to 1. So multiplying by 4, this becomes pi here, minus 4 into 1 by 2, so 2 here, and putting limit as 1 will give you log 2, putting 0 will give us 0 only because log 1 is 0. So the answer is pi minus log 4. So answer for this 20 is also true. Okay, so what was the conclusion? True, false, true. So I think all parts, especially this was very easy. This is not that easy, but still easy. This was, I will say, a little tricky, but if you remember that result of limit, then also it is easy. And this is just simple definite integration, nothing else. Now coming to question number 6. Fx is equal to 1 upon mod ln x into 1 upon x plus cos x. Okay, so this question in 21, first part, x belongs to, x approaches to infinity. So as you know, as x approaches to infinity, ln x will approach to infinity also. 1 upon x will approach to 0. Cos x will be lying within minus 1 to 1 because it's a periodic function. As x approaches to infinity, it will be lying within minus 1 to 1. So this fx, as you can see, outside thing is approaching to 0. Okay, let me write it here, 1 upon ln x mod, this is approaching to 0 because ln x is approaching to infinity. But here, if you can see 1 upon x, as x approaches to infinity, this will be approaching to 0, but this cos x will be lying within minus 1 to 1. So what they are saying, sine of fx changes infinitely many times. So I think that is true because this will be tending towards 0, whereas this lies between minus 1 to 1. So whenever this is positive, after x has become too large, I think it will more or less depend upon cos x only. If cos x is negative, this thing will be negative. If cos x is positive, this will be positive. Outside, it is approaching to 0, but it is not equal to 0. So definitely, value will be negative or positive. So this will be changing sign infinitely many times. This statement is true. Now, as x approaches to infinity, limit of fx does not exist. Dear all, as I said, outside this is approaching to 0, and inside this thing will be, you know, approaching, I will say it will be lying within some finite interval minus 1 to 1. Maybe slightly more than 1, because as x approaches to infinity, this 1 by x will be approaching to 0 plus. So when cos x becomes exactly 1, then this may become slightly bigger than 1, but still this bracket here will be lying within minus 1 to 1, which is multiplied by a very small quantity outside that is approaching to 0. So finite into approaching to 0 has to be 0 only. So the entire limit of this fx has to approaching to 0. So saying that does not exist is false. So answer for this will be false. Now coming to 23, x approaching to 1. As we know, as x approaches to 1, ln x approaches to 0. In fact, this could have approached to 0 plus also, 0 minus also, as they have not said x is approaching to 1 plus or 1 minus, but if it is mod ln x, then it has to be 0 plus only. Okay, 1 upon x will approach to 1, that's a finite number, cos x will approach to cos 1. So what we can see, this bracket inside is going to be definitely finite, but this 1 upon ln x mod, this quantity will be approaching to sure shot plus infinite, whereas inside we can definitely say it is a finite value. So finite into infinite will be infinite, so this fx will be approaching to infinite, so this is definitely true. Now coming to 24, now 0 plus, as x approaches to 0 plus, ln x approaches to minus infinite. You know the graph of ln like this. So as x approaches to 0, this graph goes to minus infinite, but we are having mod ln x, so this will be approaching to plus infinite. Okay, and as x approaches to 0 plus, 1 upon x will approach to infinite. Okay, 1 upon x will be approaching to infinite, and cos x will be, cos x will be approaching to 1. Let us see, cos x approaches to 1 here. So here what you can see, it is actually 1 upon ln x into 1 upon x plus cos x. It looks like, because this will be approaching to 0 because it is infinity in the denominator, so this has to be approaching to 0 and this has to be approaching to infinity. So this is actually 0 into infinity form. So it's an indeterminate form. We should do it, you know, separately. What I'll do, I will take the limit of this 1 upon x log x, mod log x actually, separately, plus cos x upon mod log x. And here, this second part definitely I can say is approaching to 0, because ln x is approaching to infinity and cos x is approaching to 1. So 1 upon infinity will be approaching to 0. Now please understand, limit x approaches to 0 plus, this is a very famous question, that to find this limit x ln x, we use, you know, LH rule, L-hospital rule. So how do we do it? We write ln x here and 1 upon x here. If you solve it, you get limit x approaches to 0 plus actually, and differentiation of ln x is this, and minus 1 upon x square here. So this becomes limit x approaches to 0 plus minus x after simplification, which will be actually equal to 0. So what you can see, x ln x approaches to 0. So if it is approaching to 0, so in the denominator, this thing will be approaching to 0 plus. So after doing this calculation, what we can say, that this entire thing will actually become plus infinity. You can see, because x approaching to 0, so and x approaching to 0, so x is approaching to 0, ln x is approaching to infinite, but this product, we have proved it, that is it, that it is approaching towards 0. So 1 upon 0 will be plus infinite. Actually, because of mod ln, this has to be positive. So this saying that fx approaching to 1 is false. So answer for this one will be false. So here, true, false, true, and then false. Okay, now coming to, but before that, I think this question, especially 24th, was a tricky one. 23rd was okay. 23rd was also fine, I think. 21 was also a tricky. So overall, I will say this question was tricky. Okay, now coming to next question, that is question number 7. We are given f not x is equal to x, x greater than 0. Define functions inductively by f n plus 1 x is equal to x power f n x. So f1 x is equal to x power x, f2 x is equal to x power x power x, etc. And note that f01 is 1 and f0, f dash 0 at 1 is also 1. Okay, now question number 25, it says as x approaches to 0, x approaches to 0 plus, what will be the limit of x power x? F1 x is x power x. So to do this question, what we will be doing, we will be writing this as, you know, log thing, like e power x ln x. And I think I have done this thing just now, that limit of x ln x is 0. Just now I have done it. X ln x is 0 as x approaches to 0 plus. So I think this will be e power 0, that is 1. So this 25th is true. Okay, now coming to 26. Here they are saying as x approaches to 0 plus f2x. So what we are looking for? We are looking for the limit of x approaches to 0 plus x power you can say f1x. Okay, now please listen carefully. If f1 is approaching to 1 as x approaches 0 plus, then it is actually a form of 0 raised to the power 1. It is like in the base we have 0 plus and that is having power approaching to 1. So 0 power 1 is not any indeterminate form. So we can say it has to be 0 only. So this seems to be false here. Okay, now coming to 27th, in which we are asked the integration of f3x dx. F3x integration means it will be integration of x power, I think x here. Or one more time x. So dear all, I have not seen such kind of integration being done easily at least, or maybe it is non-doable. But if they are saying it equal to 1, so most probably this has to be false, but let us see if there is any logic in it. If your x is from 0 to 1, okay, and all these functions x or x power x or x power x, they all has to be positive. They all has to be positive. They cannot be negative. Base is positive, power is positive, so everything has to be positive. So if x is from 0 to 1, so this x power x cannot become greater than 1. It has to be less than 1. Please understand. It can be 1 only at x equal to 1. It may be increasing, decreasing, I am not going into that. But I can say for sure that because my base is less than 1 and because power is positive, so the entire thing has to be less than 1. Base less than 1, power negative only can make it greater than 1. And also this power is not 0 throughout. So this x power x has to be less than 1. So if that is so, then this limit being from 0 to 1, this has to be strictly less than 1. So it being equal to 1 is just out of question. So answer for this will be false. They are claiming it to be 1. We are saying claiming it to be less than 1. So answer will be false. Now coming to 28th part. Now they are asking derivative 123rd time. So that means you are not supposed to do it actually for 123rd time. Rather, we should be doing the differentiation of, you know, n plus 1th function. So doing the differentiation of this will give you, and to do the differentiation, what we will do, d upon dx of e power f n x ln x. Or let me do it completely first. It will be written like this, e power ln of x raised to the power f n x. Okay, one very standard way of doing logarithmic differentiation. So here it will be e power fn x will be multiplied ln x here. So the differentiation here will be done using that chain rule. So fn x into ln x, and after that it will be derivative of fn into ln x plus it will be fn x upon x. Okay, this I can write back as x power, I can write this thing back to x raised to the power fn x into this fn dash x into ln x plus fn x upon x. Okay, now if we are looking for fn plus 1 dash 1, you can see this outside thing will be just 1, inside thing this thing would be fn dash 1 here. And log 1 is 0, so there is no point of writing it, it is going to be 0 only, plus fn x, at x is equal to 1, it will be 1 only, and upon 1 here. Dear all, if this derivative would be tending towards infinity, then there could have been some question whether we should multiply it with 0 and saying it 0 or not. But here we can start with putting n is equal to 0, and because we are given f dash 0 1 is equal to 1, so I can start with n is equal to 0. Okay, will give you f 1 dash is equal to 1, you can check, and then this will give you f 2 f dash 2 at 1 is equal to 1, and so on. So this derivative of f 123 at x is equal to 1 will also be 1 only. So answer is true for this question also. So true, false, false, true. This question I will say little tricky, not very tricky, but little tricky. So other is, if we compare with other question, I think this question was good. Now coming to question number 8. Here we are given n as a set as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and L is equal to ABC. Suppose we arrange 12 element of L union N. That means we make a combined set of L and N. So it will be having 12 element, 9 these digits and 3 letters, such that all 3 letters appear consecutively in any order. So in this 29th, what we will do, we will make ABC just as one object and other 9 elements as individuals. So total there will be 10 objects. To arrange them, we will have 10 factorial ways, because we are given 3 letters should appear consecutively in any order. So after A, it should be B or C or like that, but it should not be like after A, you have got some integer in between. That should not happen. But within A, B, C, this box or this object we are calling as 1, we can arrange them in 3 factorial ways. So one very standard way of doing such questions, 10 factorial into 6 would be the answer. So this is going to be false. Now coming to 30th, it says more than half of the function from N to L. Now N to L, if we find all the functions, let me call all functions as NA, all functions as NA. So it will be that you have choice to join one with A or B or C. So 3 ways, then 3 ways for 2 also. So it will be 3 power 9. But if we are given that B is in the range, so what I will do, first I will find that B is not in the range. Let us call this as B bar, that B is not in the range. So if B is not in the range, then all the elements are supposed to be joined with either A or C. So it, in that case, we will be having 2 power 9. So what we are looking for here, that element B is in the range, I think in that case, answer will be 3 power 9 minus 2 power 9. Now, what they are saying, that more than half of the function from N to L, that means this kind of functions, more than half of the function from N to L have elements B in the range. Okay, so we have to compare this with 3 power 9. So let us see, this 3 power 9 minus 2 power 9 upon 3 power 9 is greater than 1 or not, greater than half or not. I can write this as 1 minus 2 upon 3 power 9. So dear all, it looks like that 9 is a big number, very big number. 2 by 3 will become small. In fact, if you want to do it, let us just try it with some bigger powers like 2, 3, 4. It will be 4 upon 9 into 2 upon 3 power 7 here. 4 upon 9 itself is less than half, and multiplying with a number that is less than 1 will make this to be less than half. So this entire thing will become greater than half. So saying that more than half of the function have elements B in the range is definitely true. There is a nice way of asking this question. I just say this question was good question here. Now coming to next one, that is 31. Number of 1 to 1 function from L to N. Now they have reversed the order, L to N. So number of 1 to 1 function means there has to be exactly 3 image in the N, because L is having only 3 elements. So which 3 images will be there? So we will be selecting 3 image in set N from the 9 in 9C, 3 ways. And which, whatever 3 we have chosen, which one will be connected with A, which one will be connected with B, which one will be connected with C, this can be done in 3 factorial ways. So answer will be 9 into 8 into 7, I think, yeah, upon 3 factorial into 3 factorial. So this will be cancelled. Let us see how much this comes out to be 72 into 7. I think 504. So it is less than 512. Number of 11 function from L2N is definitely true. Now coming to question number 32, it says number of functions from N2L, again N2L, that do not map consecutive members to consecutive letters is greater than 512. For example, if F1 is B and F2 is A or C is not allowed, what they are saying that consecutive numbers in N, okay, number of functions that do not map consecutive numbers in N to consecutive letters. Okay, so if 1 to 2 we are going, then if 1 is mapped with B, 2 cannot be mapped with A or C because A is consecutive to B, C is also consecutive to B. Okay, but if F1 is A, then F2 is equal to C is allowed. We cannot have F2 is equal to B because A, B are consecutive, but if F1 is A, then F2 can be C. And so with F1 is equal to 2, F2 also. Okay, what they are saying that if your F1 is A, then we can have F2 also equal to A. Because A and A, we are not calling them as consecutive because A, this other A is also same as the previous A. So this is allowed, but one value having A, then next integer, let us say 2, should not have B. So this is what this question is saying. So now to count this kind of function, please understand, I will make cases. We can have F1 to be equal to A, we can have F1 to be equal to B, or we can have F1 to be equal to C. Now please understand, in this case, if F1 becomes B, then F2 has to be B only because, as they have said, we cannot have A or C. In this case, you can see all values of function has to be B, 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 only B. So there is just one way of doing this thing. Now, if F1 is A, then what are the choices for F2? I think I can have F2 to be A, or I can have this to be C. Now, if I am having A, then again I'll have two choices. If F2 I'm having C, then also for F3, we will be having two choices for each A and C. So what I can see here, that for every value A or C, every time we will be having two options. So I think I could have done one thing. I could have taken this F1 as, you know, one A or C together here. So if F1 is A, I think we will be getting this. For C also same. So what we can see here, that we are going to get in this case two ways to connect one with A or C, then again two ways to connect two with A or C, and this will be done, you know, 9 times. So we will get 2 power 9 in this case, whereas one way for when F1 will be equal to B. So in this case, we are getting 2 power 9, that is, I think, 512. So total will be 513. So the number of functions is greater than 512. So this is also true. So what is the total conclusion? False, true, true, true. So that is the answer of this 8th part. Now coming to 9th part, we are given that Z denotes a non-real complex number, that is A plus iota B form, where B is non-zero. Imaginary part is non-zero, A, B are real number, okay. And FZ is given like this, okay. Now 33 part, they are saying mod Z is equal to 1, then FZ must be real, okay. So please understand, if mod Z is 1, then mod of Z power 222 is also equal to 1. And dear all, please understand, when mod Z is 1, that means Z into Z conjugate is equal to 1. And in this case, Z conjugate becomes equal to 1 upon Z. That's a very important thing. Please understand, whenever you have a complex number whose mod is 1, then its conjugate is actually reciprocal of itself. So in this case, FZ can be written as Z power, because same will be property here also. I can write Z 2 raised to the power 222 conjugate actually equal to 1 upon Z raised to the power 222. So here FZ will be equal to 2 Z power 222 plus z conjugate, z power 222 conjugate. And sum of a number with its conjugate, definitely it should be real. So answer for this will be true. Okay, now coming to 34. 34, they are saying z plus 1 upon z is equal to 1. So if I multiply by z both sides, I will get like this. And here all you can check, this will give us roots which are actually negative of non-real cube roots of unity. You can check, this gives us minus b plus or minus iota root 3 upon 2. So this is minus omega or minus omega square. In fact, this equation should be remembered first of all, or if you remember, z square plus z plus 1 gives us roots as omega or omega square. Here we are just putting z as minus z. So from transformation of quadratic or equations, we can say roots of this would be minus omega or minus omega square. So what will be my fz if z plus 1 upon z is equal to 1? So in this case, either my z will be minus omega or it will be minus omega square. But as you know, 222 is multiple of 3. 2 plus 2 plus 2 is 6. So it has to be multiple of 3, and it's an even number also. So in both scenarios, it will be both means whether you take minus omega or minus omega square. So minus omega power 222 will also be 1, or you take minus omega square power 222, this will also be equal to 1. So hence this has to be equal to 2 only. So this also seems to be true. Now coming to 35th part, z plus 1 upon z is real, then this less than or equal to 2. Please see, if I write this as r into cos theta plus iota sine theta, then 1 upon z will be 1 upon r into cos theta minus iota sine theta. So if this z plus 1 upon z is real, which is actually is real, means its imaginary part, which is r minus 1 upon r into sine theta, it has to be equal to 0. That means either sine theta equal to 0, but that is not possible because we are given this imaginary part is non-zero. That is not true. So what is left with? We are left with r is equal to 1 by r. That gives only one possibility, that r will be equal to 1. That means once again we are getting that mod will be equal to 1. Now, if r is equal to 1, then I think z power 222 will be equal to, just mod will be 1 here, and cos of 222 theta plus iota sine 222 theta. And similar way, 1 upon z power 222 theta will be 1 into cos of 222 theta and minus iota sine of 222 theta. Adding these two, we will be getting this f of z equal to 2 times cos of 222 theta. Okay, so mod of fz, which is mod of this thing, has to be less than or equal to 2, because it, depending upon what my theta is, cos 222 theta can be at most 1 in magnitude. So this has to be less than or equal to 2. So this also seems to be true here. Now, 36, they are saying, let me use this space here, 36, fz is real number. So similar way, what I did here, if fz is real, I can say, as I said, r is equal to 1 here, that mod of z power 222 will be equal to 1. And in this case, fz will become equal to, then in that case, if it's a real number, then f of z, yeah, f of z will be z power 222 plus 1 upon z power 222 is actually equal to 2 times real part of z power 222. Because if their mod is 1, this thing will be conjugate of z power 222. Conjugate of this thing. So sum will be 2 times real part of this. But you cannot say that real part of this will be positive or it will be negative. So saying that it must be positive is wrong. So I will say this statement to be false. So here we are having TTTF. So I will say question was mixed kind of thing. 33rd was, you know, easy. I think it is easy. Second is also fine if you understand that omega. And then 35, 36 was little tricky, but not difficult, I will say. Now coming to the last question, that is question number 10. This is definitely one good question, I will say. Here they are saying, suppose that cards numbered 1, comma 2 and so on n are placed on a line in some sequence with each integer I belongs to 1, comma n. Okay, they have used this kind of bracket I. Okay, maybe they want to say each integer. Okay, so 1, 2, 3 up to n. Yeah, both side close bracket appearing exactly once. A move consists of interchanging the card labeled 1 with any other card. Okay, a move consists of interchanging the card labeled 1 with any other card. If it is possible to rearrange the cards in increasing order by doing a series of moves, we say that given sequence can be rectified. Okay, so statement 37, that sequence can be rectified in 8 moves. Okay, so let us see how this can be rectified. So let me try to do something here. And this move means we can interchange card 1 with any other card. So please see, 1 is, you know, sitting at second position. If this these cards can be in increasing order, then this place is actually for 2. So what I'm going to do for first place, I'm replacing 1 with 2. That is one move here, you can see. So 9 to 1, then 3, then 4, then 5, then 6, then 7, then 8. So that is my first move. Now I am sitting at third place, which is actually place for 3. So again, using one more move, I'll put 3 here, 1 here, then 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and so on. So you can see in first move, after first move, 1 has reached to third place. After second move, 1 has reached to fourth place. If I go on this way, I think seventh move, I will reach my 1 on the ninth place. You can see second move, 1 is at fourth place. So seventh move, this 1 will reach to 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and it will be reaching at the ninth place. Okay, and then in the end, what we can do, we can replace 9 with 1. So 9 will reach to, you know, last place, and everything is now sorted. I think it is in the increasing order. So in exactly 8 moves, we are able to rectify the sequence. But whether that is the least possible moves possible, or we can do it in fewer moves also. So to say this thing, what my arguments is that because in any move you can replace 1 with any other number. So in one of the move actually, only one number can change its place. Okay, like in first place, first move, you can see only 2 replaced with 1. Then in the second move, 3 replaced, 3 changed its position. So in every move, only one number is changing its position. Here, if you see, there are one, every number, if you check, every number here is actually not in its position. Like 1 is not in first position, 2 is not in the second position, and so on. So if there are 9 numbers, and in every move, I can change the position of only one number at most. Okay, so I think I'll require 9 moves maybe. But if I'm able to, you know, rectify 2 numbers in single move, then I think I can save one of my move, which I did in this 8th move. If you notice, 9th and 1th, they were, you know, replaced their, they exchanged their positions, and you know, this sequence was rectified. So we saved one move here, but was that possible before that also? So please understand that before that, actually in this position, in this after seventh move, what was happening, 1 and 9 were taking each other's place. So replacing each other actually rectified this thing. But here if you see, there is no number such that they are taking each other's place. Like 1 is sitting in the second position and 2 is two is one is taking second position and two is taking third position. So they are not taking each other's position. And we can, you know, interchange positions of one with some other number. So if one is taking second position, so in order to, you know, do this rectification of two, you know, wrong things in one move, you want that, like, if one is sitting at second position, two should have been sitting in the first position, but that is not happening here. So I think at least 8 moves has to be taken, otherwise we will not be able to do it. So I think answer for this should be true. Now coming to 38, the sequence can be rectified in 8 moves and no fewer moves. So once again, let us see what exactly is going on here. So 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, okay, 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, okay, here, and 2 is sitting here, okay. Okay, so 1 is already in its position, but if we want to do some moves, I think 1 has to be misplaced first, and then it should be brought back to its position, okay. And also you can see every number is not in their positions, like 3 is on the second, 4 is in the third, and so on, okay. So what we can do to do this, I think, because all nine numbers are not in their positions, so here I think doing it in 8 moves will not be possible. Let us see at least one way if we can do it or not. Let us see. 1 interchange with 3. Just 1 minute. 3 is in the second position. Okay. If I replace 1 with 2, 2 will come in the first position, 1 will go into the last position, but that is not the objective. Okay. One of the way is like that I do one thing, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and I replace 2 here and 1 here. Okay, and then every time I replace 1 with 9, so 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 9 here. So 9 is now in its position, then replace 1 with 8. So it will be 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 1, 8. Now 8 and 9 both are in their position. So every time I'll be doing this thing, and the entire sequence will be in proper order. But for that, you can check. This was my first move. And after that, every number has to be rectified. So we will be requiring more than 8 moves here. So this is not true. I think it is false here. Okay, and I don't see any reason why in single move, two numbers will be, you know, replacing each other, and they will be actually rectifying this wrong thing here. Just let me think. 1 with 2 is not doing that. Okay, in first move, there is no such thing that 1 can go at any position. 1 is already in its position, so wherever one is going, it is actually not making things proper. Okay, and after that, if I do this move, okay, in that case, you can see 1 is not in its position, so taking a move will not do that thing that two numbers are, you know, reaching at their position that I did, you know, in this case here, 7 to 8 here. So I think here this is not possible. Now coming to this 39th, they are saying the sequence cannot be rectified. So let us see why, if possible, that cannot be rectified. Let us see. So here 1, 3, 4, 2, 9, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 5, 6, 7, 8 is here in the order, then 3, 4 here, 9 here, and 2 here. Okay, 1 is already in its position. So now if I want to bring this 2 in the second position, now there is no count on the moves. So maybe we can take any number of moves, but we just have to see whether this can be rectified or not rectified. Okay. So if I want 2 to be at the second position, what I can do first, I replace 1 with 3. 1 with 3. So 3, 1, 4, 2, 9, 5, 6, 7, 8. And now, if I replace 1 with 3, so I will make sure that 2 is now reaching its own position. Okay. So this is something I think that may guarantee that I can bring any number to its position. Let us see one more time. Like 3 is in the first position now, and I want this to be at the third position. So what I'll do first, I'll be first, you know, interchanging 1 with 4. So 3, 2, 1, 4, 9, 5, 6, 7, 8. So, and then I'll move 1 here, 3 here. So I'll be having 1 here, 2 here, 3 here, 4, 9, 5, 6, 7, 8. So I think I have, you know, made it possible that these three numbers, so like I think 3, 2, 4, they are now in their own position. Now to bring 5 in the fifth position, so 1, 2, 3, 4, fifth position is this one. So first I will be replacing 9 with 1, okay, and then I will be replacing 5 with 1, so 5 will be taking its own position. So similar way if we keep on doing, I think it looks like every sequence can be rectified. It is not just this sequence. So answer for this sequence, answer should be false. They are saying cannot be rectified. So answer for this should be false. Now coming to 40th. It says there exists a sequence of 99 cards. So I think they are saying the cards will be 99 in number. So 1, 2, 3 up to 99. There exists a sequence that cannot be rectified. I think this I have already answered in this 39th part, that going with this way, which is one very logical way, I think every number can be brought to its own position. I'll just give one example. Suppose my R is some number that is sitting at mth position, okay, and at rth position there is some other number, let us say S, who is sitting, and one is sitting somewhere else, okay. So what we can do, if I want R to reach here, first I will replace one with S. So what I will be having now, S here, R is unchanged till this point, and now 1 here, R here. Now if I replace 1 with R, so I think I have brought this R at its position. That means we can, you know, replace, we can send every number to its position. That means we can, rectify any such sequence. So this is also false. So what is the answer of this? True, true, false, false, false. So this completes the solutioning of this question, and this question was really tricky, I will say. So this completes the solutioning of this entire paper. Next week I will be taking B part, and then I will be taking 23rd May also. Okay, thank you so much everybody. Bye, take care, thank you.